Good morning. The peace of the Lord be with you. Today is the third Sunday of Pentecost, and it is graduation Sunday, which means we'll be recognizing the graduates from our church today. Kaylee will be making a presentation to the graduates during the first part of the service this morning. The children will be dismissed for children's church after the children's moment, and high school and middle school students will be dismissed after the sermon. There will be a meeting for all parents of students up to age of confirmation related to children's and youth ministries this summer and next fall. This is after church, so we'll be meeting upstairs in the Buxton room after we get our coffee and also see a video presentation related to the graduates. We welcome all of you to worship service, including those of you who are worshiping online today. We are an open and affirming UCC church, and you are welcome here no matter where you're from, who you love, or where you are at on your spiritual journey. We welcome everyone because Jesus excluded no one. I also want to say a special welcome to Andrew Freeman, our guest musician today. Daniel's away this Sunday, and he was having trouble finding a sub, and I said, well, I know somebody. Andrew's a very good friend of mine, and we've known each other for many years. And he and his husband, Eric, live in West Hartford, Connecticut. He actually went to the same seminary I went to, but I was also, his mom grew up in the church that I formerly served. So I not only know him, but his like whole family. But a very good friend, and I thank you, Andrew, for being here today. The flowers, I forgot to pick that up, are in memory of, can you check in your bulletin? Somebody, you shouted out. Sorry, I meant to write that down, and I forgot. Victor Ruzio. From Maria Duncan, who also arranged the flowers today. Is that right? Did I get it right? I'm sorry. Good. I also want to take a moment right now. Is Brooke Canada here? Brooke, come on up. So we wanted to say a special thank you to Brooke. For those of you who don't know, Brooke has been our Director of Communications for the past 4 years?
4 years.
4 years. And she has been a true blessing to me, even though I've only been here a couple months. I'm really glad you were here when I came and received all of her support, and her communication and her awareness of everything going on in our church has been immensely supportive. And I'm grateful also just to have gotten to know her. She's been hired full-time to work for the UCC National in She's going to be working remote, but for UCC National in Cleveland. And so our church, I just want to thank you for your service to us, but also your service to the UCC and your continued support of our denomination. We give you thanks, and you'll always be in our prayers. And we have a card and a gift card to one of your favorite restaurants. We had to drive all the way to Brookfield to get the gift card, so my wife and I were like, oh, well, we might as well give the restaurant a try as well. So, it's now one of our favorite places, too. So. But thank you. Let's give her a big round of applause.
It's been a blessing to serve this church. It really has. And I look forward to following you continually from now on, too. So.
I said she can stay and worship with us as long as she wants. Absolutely. Thank you very much. Psalm 121:1 says, I will lift my eyes to the hills. Where will my help come? My help comes from the Lord who made heaven and earth. Would you please stand and join in our call to worship?
Good morning. In love and joy, God calls us together.
And so we meet this day as friends,
as neighbors, as sisters and brothers in Christ. Called together by God, we bring our offerings and our whole selves to God.
Our songs, our hearts, our prayers, our lives.
Grateful for this opportunity to give and receive, let us worship God.
Let us pray together. God, I give you thanks for this day. Thanks for each person here today and the blessings that you've provided in each one of our lives. God, help us to receive your love and your grace and to share it with others in our worship this morning. We pray these things in Jesus' holy name. Amen. Would you please take a moment and pass the peace with one another?
Blessing.
Please remain standing and join in singing our hymn number 417. This is a day of new beginnings. Stanzas 1-4. To our graduates. Do you have a microphone? Okay.
I've got one.
Good morning. This is an incredibly exciting time in the life of youth ministry. At the end of each school year, we make a point to celebrate not only our graduates, but all of our students. When I say we, I'm going to ask for a moment if you have in the past, in the last 18 years in any way, worked with these students as they were toddlers, as they were elementary students, as they were high school students. Before we present these awards, I want our students to know who this we is that we're talking about when we celebrate them. So if you have worked with any of our students in the last 18 years, would you take a minute to please stand? This is the we that we present our children with. This is the panel of celebration. These are the people that have been with us and walked with these students. So now, with this recognition, I think it's time that we can celebrate them. Please be seated. This morning, we have 16 graduates. And that's not everybody that's just finished a school year. We have 16 people that have graduated from medical school, some from college and university, high school, eighth grade, and fifth grade. We have 16 of those students to celebrate this morning. So I'm gonna go a little quick, and I'm gonna tell you that after church in the fellowship hall, there will be a PowerPoint set up that will tell you a little bit more about all of these students and what they've been doing and what they're going to do. If you are here, students, when I read your name, would you come to the front? Our first celebration, I don't even think Christina is here with us, but Emily Carroll graduated from Western Michigan Medical School this past couple of weeks. She's moving on to do her residency in what's called a triple board, something incredibly impressive. So Emily, we celebrate you. See, I think I saw Mom. Jack Peluso, the daughter of Diane Peluso, the daughter of, that's, he's the son of Diane Peluso, graduated with his bachelor's in science from Providence College. He'll be staying in the area to do his master's of business, am I correct? Yes, also at Providence College. Jack, we celebrate you. Okay, Abby Steckman. I was hoping that Christine Callahan would be here this morning, because in all truthfulness, these are some people, the people I asked to stand, are the people that Abby has known as her church. I'm new to this, and all I get to do is the honor to celebrate everything that you have done. So Abby is going to Lipscomb University in Nashville, Tennessee, to study music. She, as you all are rightfully aware, has been a key role in the life of our music ministry program here at First Church. I think I've heard stories that you started singing at like that big. Yeah, yeah. And you started singing here not long after that. Abby was a confirmand in 2019. Her youth leader for a long time was both Marisa Brown Ludwig and Christine Callahan. It's also with their blessing that I came here to celebrate you. So Abby, we celebrate you. And because you're the first one here this morning, I can actually hand you a gift. So we were thinking about, Doug and I and the greater youth ministry team, about what gifts would be most meaningful and practical. So you will find in your gift this book called the Little Red Book of Wisdom. And when I showed this to Doug, he said, those are some really interesting chapter names. God Owns It All, A Wild Perspective on Things, The Wisdom of Firsts, A Turtle on a Fence Post, Appreciate How You Got Where You Are, There Are No Degrees of Integrity, A Proverb a Day, Wisdom for Every Aspect of Your Life, Wisdom of Age, Seeking Out the Support of Our Elders, Being the Best Defense is a Good Defense, Why I Won't Ride Along with Those Who I Don't Support, and so many more that we wanted to share with you when you leave this place, a little piece of what hopefully has become to be a safe space for you, that your faith and your church and these little bits of wisdom, and that hopefully you will remember not only your church, but the church that you've been serving for the last year in East Longmeadow. I'm actually gonna put an asterisk. Did you know that she's been working at the East Longmeadow Church as a soprano section leader for the last year? That's this, yeah. Mary gave a praise hands, and I completely agree. So along with some wisdom that we hope to impart, there's also a practical gift, which is a computer stand. Oh, nice. As you move on into a dorm and into a new life, hopefully it's more for computer than it is Netflix, or more for homework than Netflix, but we hope that whenever you see or use these gifts that you remember the people that support you and care about you.
Thank you.
You're so welcome. I don't believe I saw the DeSaros, but our next graduate from high school is Faye DeSaro, who's a lifelong, her family has been here for a long time. She will be going to, it's off the top of my head, she's going to Denison University in Ohio to study data analytics. Analytics, there we go. So, Faye, we celebrate you. Our next graduate from Long Meadow High School is Kylie Smith. Kylie worked with us and was an active part of our youth group program. She was a confirmand in 2019. And for some time, she worked with the children, being upstairs in the nursery classroom. She will be going off to university this coming year. Not sure where, but that is her plans. And so for that, Kylie, we celebrate you. Mary Freeman, I'm not going to ask you to stand all the way up here, but I'm going to tell you that Nina Hutchins is Mary Freeman's granddaughter and has just graduated from Long Meadow High School. She is a family member of someone beloved to our church, and for that, Nina, we celebrate you. Another beloved name are the Olsons. Piper Olson graduated from Long Meadow High School this last Thursday. She was also a confirmand in 2019. Her grandmother served our church for a really long time as the secretary, and again, is one of those faces that, although I didn't get to meet, was incredibly important to the life of our congregation. And for this, Piper, we celebrate you. The last of our high school students today is Pippa Berry, who graduated from Wilston School in Northampton on the 25th of May. She was also a confirmand in 2019, a key part of our programming here. And for all of this, Pippa, we celebrate you. Our next batch of kiddos is our middle school crew. And Wendy, do you mind stepping up here? Our first middle schooler that is being celebrated today is Ava Steckman, younger sister to Abby, who has graduated from from Williams. And she has recently, and I wouldn't say, in the last almost year and a half, it's been some time that we've been getting to know her. She's come to camp lock-in and Sunday school, and she's been a beautiful addition to the life of our youth program as it is now. And for all of this and more, Ava, we celebrate you. Our next is my dear student, Callie. Would you come up here, Callie? So, Callie has graduated eighth grade from the Pioneer Valley Chinese Immersion School in South Hadley. She's been going there since, fourth grade, oh my goodness. So this is, she'll move up into the, I believe you literally move up, as in you move floors, is that correct? Yes, you move up literally into high school programming at the Pioneer Valley Chinese Immersion School. For all that you have been active here and for so much more, Callie, we celebrate you. I think I saw him. Ethan, would you step up here? Ethan Lee is graduating from Glenbrook Middle School. He's been a part of track and robotics, and what else have you been working on? Cello, right? How could I forget about cello? He just ran in the state track meet, what was that, yesterday? Yes, for two different events. Yeah, yeah. He's like, okay, stop talking about me. Yes. Because we care about you, we take time to talk about you and to celebrate you. So, Ethan, congratulations. Our last middle school student, although isn't here with us this morning, is the granddaughter of Nancy Russell. Her name is Winifred Jones, and she's graduated from one of Northampton's middle schools. Nancy actually called this week and asked that we included her student, and I thought that was for a grandmother to support her grandchild in that way. It was incredibly sweet. So, Winifred, we celebrate you. We got two more, our first and nearly last middle elementary school celebration is for Avery Creelman, and Cindy is sitting over here. So this is Cindy's graduate, Avery. And Avery is graduating from Center Elementary School. She has played every sport under the sun. Avery's also been a part of our middle school programming informally for the last year, kind of testing out waters as we now, as she has graduated fifth grade, she is a full-fledged member of our youth ministry programming. And for all that you've done in school and in church, Avery, we celebrate you. And I've got one more freshly graduated elementary school student who will be moving up into youth and middle school programming. And her name is Sophie Hudson. Would you come forward, Sophie? One of the things that we do, and the reason we choose to celebrate graduations like fifth and eighth grade, because they're not only special in the life of school, but they're also significant to us in the life of the church. As our students graduate fifth grade, we announce that they are moving up. They have come to a point where they are now going to join us for middle school programming, which means we stay with and we worship together with our congregation a little longer. We sit and we do activities on Fridays, and there's a whole bunch that welcomes you into middle school programming. So, Sophie, for what you've done in school and for what you've done in your children's ministry programming, we celebrate you. They've graduated. They've done it. I want to take a second. If you are a student in any other way, if you are a student currently in school, or if you're in the midst of a degree, maybe you're not quite an eighth grader yet, but if you are a student who's just finished a school year, would you please stand? Congratulations, everybody. Your hard work is noticed by us. We care about you. We see all that you do during the school year, and we can't wait to celebrate you and see what you do in the future. Amen.
I have a really loud mouth, but which microphone would you like me at?
We'll go here. Hi, I'm Sue McNary. I'm here representing the music committee here at First Church. Carrie and Daniel not being here today, they have asked me to present the Ruth Perry Award. Ruth Perry, for those of you who don't know, was a former music director here for many years, and upon her retirement, the church established this award. The Ruth Perry Award is given to a graduating student who has been a part of our music ministry here at First Church, and I'm getting emotional. Oh my goodness. This person today, oof, I didn't expect that. So this year's recipient has blessed us on so many occasions with her gifts, including today, yay. And I have loved seeing her grow as a musician, singer, performer over the years, as a former music teacher myself, seeing her at districts and Allstate and everything, and I'm just always so proud of this young woman and so excited for what she's about to accomplish in the world. She has been active, and I was reading her application for the award, and my gosh, and like all kinds of great community events and church events. And anyways, to keep it short and sweet, on behalf of the music committee of First Church, I present this year's Ruth Perry Award to Abby Steckman.
That's a hard act to follow. Our reading today is Genesis chapter 12, verses 1 through 9. In this reading, God calls Abram to leave, go, and become a blessing in the promised land. Now the Lord said to Abram, go from your country and your kindred and your father's house to the land that I will show you. I will make of you a great nation, and I will bless you and make your name great so that you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and the one who curses you, I will curse. And in you, all the families of the earth shall be blessed. So Abram went, as the Lord had told him, and Lot went with him. Abram was 75 years old when he departed from Haran. Abram took his wife Sarai and his brother's son Lot, and all the possessions that they had gathered, and the persons whom they had acquired in Haran, and they set forth to the land of Canaan. When they came to the land of Canaan, Abram passed through the land to the place at Shechem, to the oak of Moreh. At that time, the Canaanites were in the land. Then the Lord appeared to Abram and said, "To your offspring I give this land." So he built there an altar to the Lord who had appeared to him. From there he moved on to the hill country on the east of Bethel and pitched his tent, with Bethel on the west and Ai on the east, and there he built an altar to the Lord and invoked the name of the Lord. And Abram journeyed on by stages to the Negev. Here ends our reading. May it be a blessing in our lives.
Message. I love coffee in the morning. I don't know why. I didn't start drinking coffee until I was 40 years old. So, but once I started, it's like there's no stopping. But I have a lot of coffee mugs that I just really like, and they have to be a certain size and a certain weight. And this is one that I like, but I find certain coffee mugs kind of embarrassing. Like one I have says number one dad on it, you know? So like it's fine at home, but if people saw it, I'd be like, feel like I'm bragging a little, or it like, Stan actually has a t-shirt that says number two dad, I almost made it. It's very funny. But his is far more humble. But this is another one I get slightly embarrassed by. It says blessed on it. And I kind of feel like, I definitely feel blessed in my life, but I feel kind of odd claiming that in public. So in private, it's fine. But in public, I'm like, it's kind of strange to walk around saying you're blessed, because it feels a little bit like bragging. And you certainly don't want to go around with a t-shirt or a bumper sticker saying blessed in that I'm better than anybody else around me, right? That's not how I feel. And so what I realized from the Bible passage we just read is God said to Abraham, I'm sending you out and I will bless you to be a blessing to others. And I thought the way we should show other people that we're blessed is by being a blessing. And you can bless other people simply by being kind, by being loving, by being supportive, by coming alongside people when they're going through a hard time. So rather than walk around with t-shirts or coffee mugs or bumper stickers on our cars saying we're blessed, I think it's far better to be more subtle about it and to show people we're blessed by being a blessing. Isn't that a good idea? Can we pray together? God, I thank you for each child here, for your place in their lives and in all of our lives. And we pray that we can receive your blessing as we seek to be a blessing to others. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You can go to Children's Church. Thank you. See you later. Thank you. Over the past couple of weeks, I was presenting a class called Progressive Christianity 101, and in that class, I shared with people that I kind of got surprised in my first few weeks of preaching here because a sermon series sort of emerged around the theme of mystery that I didn't really intend, but each one of the sermons I preached had something to do with mystery. I also referred to Richard Rohr's theory that the meaning in our lives is broken up into three tiers or levels of story in our lives. He talks about the first tier being my story, the second tier being our story, and the top tier being the story. My story has to do with each one of our personal stories, our lives, how we're living them, what's going on in them. Our story has to do with the groups or organizations we are a part of, like this particular church. And then the story is related to the bigger things that we as human beings are a part of. That is what I mean by the mystery of our faith. And there are some biblical stories that we read that help us as human beings to connect with the story. And there are some Bible stories that help us understand that the story is ultimately what we belong to, or at least something that we need to be aware of. Richard Rohr says, biblical religion at its best honors and combines all three levels: personal journey as the raw material, communal identity as a school or training ground, and truth's transcendence as the integration and gathering place for all the parts together. He says we call it holiness, or in its ultimate form, wholeness. What I think he is saying is that we as individuals each have a story, an unfinished story that we're living out here on earth. And the groups we associate with also have a story, including our teams, our schools, our churches, our communities, and the nation to which we belong. But he's suggesting that true transcendence can only be found or experienced in the story, not my story or our story. On the level of my story, he says that we need to be clear about the difference between individuation and individualism. Individuation has to do with finding meaning in what makes us as individuals unique. Individualism has to do with believing that we as individuals are somehow better than or more important than others. And he suggests that this type of egocentrism can be dangerous. He also goes on to say that group egocentricity is far more dangerous than our personal egocentricity. And this would be exemplified in what we see in the worlds of white supremacy and also Christian nationalism, where all of a sudden the group takes on a bigger and more meaningful identity in a very destructive and diabolical way. But the story with transcendent meaning, the story, helps all of us, no matter who we are or where we come from, to feel a sense of belonging to what ultimately matters in our lives and in our world. It embraces the soul as the center of our religious identity. So many stories in the Bible have transcendent meaning and help us to associate ourselves with it, and we need to understand these things that come from God. In Genesis 12, 1 through 2, it says, "Now the Lord said to Abram, go from your country and your kindred and your father's house to the land that I will show you, and I will make you a great nation, and I will bless you and make your name great so that you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you and curse those who curse you, and in you all the families of the earth shall be blessed." I think it's interesting that it ends with all the families of the earth shall be blessed. Abraham is one biblical character who clearly gained confidence from the relationship that he had with God through faith. Abraham developed the confidence and courage to leave everything behind him to go after what God had in mind for him. This is what we call transcendent meaning. In Hebrews 11:8, it says, "By faith, Abraham obeyed when he was called to set out for the place that he was to receive as an inheritance. And he set out not knowing where he was going." Most of you know that I've been a pastor for 30 years and that I served two different churches for 15 years each. And when I felt like it was time for me to go, to leave the places where I was serving, to follow a calling to a new location, in both places, people made a unique comment to me. Not everybody, but somebody from the midst of those congregations said they admired my courage. And I was always kind of struck by the comment, and I got it and I didn't at the same time. They admired my courage. And then I paused and thought about it, and I'm like, yeah, there is, I guess, some courage in when you leave a place you're very familiar with to go somewhere new and start over again. It's the part I love about it, too. The not knowing. Like when I came here, I met a few of you who were on the search committee, and y'all were really nice people and everything, and we had a good conversation, and they gave me confidence about our church here. But then when you're announcing that you're going and you're moving forward and you're making this big step, you're like, yeah, I have no idea what we're getting into. Right? I mean, I kind of do, but I kind of don't. So I was reflecting on this going, not knowing where you're going. Then this last past week, I was talking to Mary Friedman, who had a dinner at her home for my wife and I with her husband and a young man named Freno, Dr. Freno, who came to us from Haiti just a couple weeks ago. And then this past week, she commented, because she was leading our Bible study and studying the text I'm about to preach from. And she said, wow, think about Freno coming here from Haiti. Talk about not knowing where you're going. And also think about all that he left behind when he came here. It sort of made me feel a whole lot less courageous in relationship to my own journey. But you can see the pattern of leaving things behind and moving forward with courage. Genesis 12:1 through 9 uses the word bless or blessing five different times. And somebody once told me, when you see a word repeated over and over again in the midst of a portion of scripture, you know what the subject is, right? But God told Abraham, as he sent him out from this place to a new place, that he would be blessed in order to be a blessing. You know, I know Father's Day's coming up, and I have two daughters who are young women. They both got married last summer. And my hope, my ultimate hope as a father, is that I was a blessing to them. Now, both my daughters would clearly testify that I was not a perfect father, right? Because there are no perfect parents. But I'm pretty confident that they would say that they were blessed with the imperfect parents they were given. And that makes me feel good. But what makes me feel even better, or the thing I'm most proud of with my kids, is when I see them being a blessing to others. I'm proud of all their accomplishments, all their awards and all their recognitions and things that they've received through the years. But what I'm truly proud of is when I see my kids being a blessing to others. And they've both done that in two totally different ways. But they're a blessing to friends, they're a blessing to neighbors, they're a blessing to other children, they're a blessing to so many people who they have impacted so far in their young lives. But I'm most grateful for those times when I see them being a blessing to others. One thing I want to be clear about is the difference between privilege and blessing. Some of us are privileged just by where we were born, what country we were born in, the place where we live. I gotta admit, when I met Frano, we started talking about our move here, and all we could talk about was all the stuff we had no room for, and the fact that we even had to rent a storage unit, which I swore I would never do in my life. And I haven't even been back to it since we moved here. But as Americans, we live with a lot of privilege, and sometimes in the midst of that privilege, we accumulate way more stuff than we possibly could ever use, right? It's kind of crazy. And privilege should force us to want to bear responsibility in relationship to others. But blessing is when we leave our stuff behind and we move forward toward what God has in mind for us in terms of how God wants us to be a blessing to others. So the blessing we get is what God does to empower us to have the kind of courage he wants in our lives to leave stuff behind to move forward toward the purpose and the transcendent meaning that God has in mind for each and every one of our lives. I was thinking about this thing of being a blessing, and I love blessing people. I had a friend in my first church in Connecticut. He said to me, Pastor Doug, he said, the reason I come to church every Sunday is for the benediction. I'm like, you gotta be kidding me. All those hours I pour into my sermons and you come for the benediction, which is like one Bible verse I read at the end of the service every week, and I don't really even prepare it until I'm in the midst of it. But actually, I knew what he meant. What he meant was he liked the feeling of being blessed at the end of each service as he was about to begin the week that he had ahead of him. And I thought that was pretty cool. And then I thought, you know, it's part of being a pastor that I love, is the chance to bless people. And sometimes that's through written formal prayers, and sometimes that's simply through the work we do as a church together. Because I believe we're given an opportunity to bless the lives of others by being the church together and by being the church in relationship to the community in which we serve and the world which we're a part of. So God blesses us in order to be a blessing. But we bless people, like I said to the kids, not just through our words of blessing, but also through our actions, and also through the things we say and do in relationship to each other in private, not just in public, but also in public. A couple of Saturdays ago, our church represented, or a few of us represented our congregation in the Pride Parade in Springfield. And I gotta tell you, I felt like it was a blessing to be there representing our church and sending a message to our community that you're safe and welcome here. There were actually several people who stopped by and said, oh, I know your church. I drive by that every day. And now I feel even more like possibly paying attention were coming to visit. But by being there and by being one of the churches represented, we were able to say, this is who we are, and this is what matters to us. We want all people to feel welcome and all people to feel safe here. Today, Kayla, you did a beautiful job blessing our graduates. And whether they're here in person or not, we're thankful and grateful for them. It's one example. I mean, most of these folks I barely even know at this point, but I've heard about them and I've heard from Kaylee about them. But it was great, right, to be able to bless each and every one of our graduates today. And I wanted to conclude our time together with a blessing for them. God's calling students, especially the ones graduating from high school, to go to new places, to experience new things, and to be a blessing in their future. No matter what your major is, no matter what you're studying or hoping for, my hope for you is that you'll be a blessing wherever you go and however God leads you. So now may God be with you, now and always. May God guide you in all the important decisions you are making. May God give you courage in relationship to the directions you're taking. May God strengthen you in the places where you feel weak. May God encourage you in the places where you feel discouraged. And may God allow faith to help you overcome any fear that may be holding you back. May God help you to know who you are and whose you are. You are a child of God, created in God's image, and may you be confident that God wants what is best for you and from you. God always wants you to be blessed and a blessing at the same time. Amen and amen.
Creator's love will receive us there. Mandy here? Is Mandy here?
She said not now.
Miss Vertigo.
He's doing okay. It takes sometimes when you feel dizzy and fall if you want to move. It makes it even quieter. But we just take a minute to pray. God, we just pray for healing, help, and strength. Pray for peace in this time, and just pray for comfort and guidance as we go through this. Help. The vertigo or whatever it is that took place to go away, and for the spinning to stop. God, we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Why don't we take a minute to just greet your neighbor and say hello and talk. We'll get the joys and concerns. Thank you.
pastor a long time, and this has happened on numerous occasions to me. Not that I bring that bad luck, but people do, they stand quickly after, or they feel like something's going wrong, and it can, but he's doing okay. Thank you all for your help. Yeah. Thank you all. Are there any other concerns or expressions of joy that you'd like to share at this time?
While we were speaking of leaving your country and coming to a new place, I want to just remember that back in 2005, we were blessed to welcome Pastor Harmon Togba and his wife Grace, who left their country, their land, and came to a very, very new, different place, and with the courage and trust in the Lord. Yeah, so you've been a blessing to us.
Amen.
I want to thank all of you for the support that you have given to us and our daughter Jennifer and her family since their house burned. This week, we witnessed the demolition and removal of the burned house. And I want to tell you, it was about as much fun as watching a dog die, but it took all day. So right now, where their home will be is an empty hole in the ground, and it's still pretty painful. They are in such a gratitude for all of the support they've received from their family and all of you and their community. But please still keep them in your prayers.
These are the prayer requests from the people that are online. From Betty Lee, continued prayers of healing for Carrie. And from Mike, prayers for the greater good of First Church and the congregation.
Prayers of thanksgiving to our beautiful daughter, Abigail, as she graduates high school and goes to Nashville for music and embarks on her life. And thank you so much to what the church has done for her. You have blessed her. So we thank you.
Thank you.
I want to give thanks to all of you for the prayers for my daughter, who is still undergoing treatments for cancer, but will be married next Friday in St. Paul's Church in the in Stockbridge, and have a celebration that was supposed to have happened in India in January. So we are rejoicing in that. Thank you.
What is her name?
And prayers for healing for Annie Wolpert, who had her hip replaced. Let's be thinking of her over the next few weeks as she heals. And if anyone wants to give a meal, let me know.
So they should contact you for meals? Yeah.
Thank you. So, prayers for my father. He was in the hospital overnight. He might have had a stroke, but we don't know at this point, so we're just hoping for the best.
What is his name?
James.
And prayers for Mark. He's my friend's son. He had a stroke during a medical procedure, and he's not really responsive, so they're not sure what's going to happen. Thank you.
Thank you.
It's a joy for me to be here from Evanston, Illinois. I left 6 years ago. My name is Candy Heafy, and I'm staying in Amherst. I'm staying in Amherst, Massachusetts, with my daughter and her family. And I'm just so drawn to come down here. I wanted to meet Doug in person, although I've seen him online, and to see people that I've known and loved for many years. Thank you.
Thanks, Candy. Let us pray together. Loving God, we turn our hearts and minds to you this morning. We are grateful for all the graduates this morning and all those moving to new schools and places in their lives during this coming year. Be with each of them and be with all of us in these times of transition and new beginnings for our church. May our world be blessed, be a blessing for us, and may we be a blessing within it. Let your Spirit bring about a new age of truth and justice and peace for our world. O Lord, we are all your children, and as your children, we pray that you will hear us as we look forward to a time when all promises will be fulfilled, the time spoken about by the prophets. Today we pray for Ann Wolpert, who is recovering from her hip replacement surgery, and just pray for your healing care. We continue to pray for Carrie Miller as he continues his stay in the hospital, and we ask you to be with Betty Lee and their family in this time. We continue to pray for Bev Seeger, who continues with her treatments and ongoing battle with cancer. We lift up Mike's prayer of a greater good for First Church in the future. We also continue to pray for Mark as he recovers from his episode this morning in worship. Be a source of strength and healing for him. We pray for all our loved ones who we know are facing challenges related to health and relationships. If we are ill today, heal us. If we are grieving, comfort us. If we are tired, strengthen us. If we are hopeless, give us hope. If we are filled with fear, give us faith. We give thanks for Candy this morning and her presence with us from Evanston, Illinois. She moved away and is glad to be back again today visiting with us, and we rejoice that she's here. We give thanks for Brooke Canada and the wonderful opportunity you've given her to work for the broader church, and pray your blessings upon her new beginning at this time also. We pray for our search team seeking to find a replacement for our director of communications position. We give thanks for Jennifer and her family. We lift up the pain of seeing their home that was burnt down, torn down. But we give thanks for the fact that this step in the journey is a preparation for what comes next. And we pray as their home is rebuilt and their lives come back together again after the fire. We give thanks for Abigail, who's going to Nashville, and pray over her time a new beginning, and give thanks for the wonderful recognition and celebration we had today. We pray over Linda Doherty as she continues on in her journey with cancer, but also as she prepares to be married at St. Paul's Church coming up, a wedding ceremony that was delayed, but we give thanks that it has now arrived, and we pray her blessings on her healing and on her marriage as well. We give thanks for the blessing of leaving things behind and moving forward. And we lift up Pastor Haman Topa and his wife Grace, and for their place here in the life of our church, and for the new beginnings that they have experienced. God, we lift up James, who is in the hospital and might have had a stroke, and we just pray that your healing power would be with him and that his recovery would be full and complete. Help us always as a church to rejoice with those who rejoice and to weep with those who weep in fellowship with one another. Bless and be known to us again and again. We pray these things in Jesus' name, and we continue to pray as he has taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Jesus said, it is more blessed to give than to receive. Please bring your offerings at this time, whether you're here in person or online, you're able to bring your offerings in a variety of ways. Thank you. Give you thanks for these good gifts and for the good gifts that you provide in each one of our lives. Help us to use your gifts in accordance with your priorities and for your purposes. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Regarding announcements, Diane Peluso will come forward at this time and offer the call to our annual meeting. I forgot to do that last Sunday. But
the 307th annual meeting of the First Church of Christ in Long Meadow will be held within the 10 a.m. service of worship on Sunday, June 18th, for the following purposes: to receive and act upon the annual reports of the offices and officers and teams, and to approve the annual budget for 2024, and to elect the officers and members of teams and committees. And the 307th annual meeting of the First Parish of Long Meadow will be held following the annual meeting on Sunday, June 18th, for the following purposes: to accept the report and to elect the slate of officers. Thank you.
Next Sunday is also Father's Day, and it's our last Sunday of the program year and our annual meeting at the end of the service. Next Sunday will also be Kaylee's last Sunday with us until she goes to work at Silver Lake Camp this summer. And so I'll take a little break at the beginning of the service to recognize her and the good work she's doing here with us and to pray for her as she heads off to camp. It's also, Daniel will be back with us next Sunday. And he's so quiet, Daniel. I don't know if you've noticed that about him. He's getting married the week after. So he's going to be away the last week in June. But I want to take a moment next Sunday to acknowledge Daniel and to celebrate the fact that he's about to get married. So you can also, if you want to bring him a card or something, I think that would be lovely. So downstairs after worship today, there will be the special presentation that Kaylee spoke of. So if you're going to the parent meeting, please go downstairs, grab your coffee, watch the special presentation, and then we'll meet upstairs in Buxton Hall. So we're having a parent meeting to talk about confirmation program, and also this summer's programming. We're gonna have a 3-day kids camp this summer, and I wanted to tell you about that. And also, as we look toward the fall, our children and youth activities that are coming up. So if you're able to join us and you're a parent, it would be great to have you there. And if the confirmation age students going into 8th or 9th grade would like to join us, they're welcome to be a part of that as well. So children, if you have kids in the church school, they will go back to church school after they get a snack downstairs. So they will be supervised if you need parental supervision during the meeting, just so you know. I think that's it. So let us now join in singing our closing hymn, I Know Who Holds Tomorrow.
I know.
And now for the long-awaited benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.